MacLib, this is a dynamic and interactive graphics and stack questions without JavaScript. So I have to be sure to get it right. Okay, so we have seen in this conference JSX graph interfaces to LaTeX syntax, which was very interesting to me, to MyOpenMap, and also to a Scratch type interface. And here comes a sort of interface to Maxima within the stack framework. However, it's not a one-to-one interface, but with own special objects. And so the outline of this presentation, I just give a short introduction, who we are, what we do with e-assessment in engineering mechanics at our university, and what potential we've identified for JSX graph and stack for e-learning. And then I've announced a year ago on the conference number one, concept for free body diagrams and e-assessment of them. And I just will give an overview of the current state. And then of course, give a summary and an outlook. So I am teaching mechanical engineering and engineering mechanics at the technical of the University of Applied Science in Brandenburg. That's 40 kilometers in the west of Berlin, so in East Germany. And Dennis Schulz is a student of mine, third year student who did some, who produced some of the code and did testing and contributed also to the presentation. So the motivation for me was that why do I want to have e-learning materials in engineering mechanics? The main thing is our students are very heterogeneous, not only motivated by the Corona policy, but also by general the fact that the students are very different and some learn very fast, some learn very slow. And I want to give them option to learn on their own pace without me having to be around for that. And still leaving them with instant feedback. That's the idea of Moodle tests and stack. And of course, this also gives them the opportunity for continuous feedback during the term without me having to fight with piles of paperwork for homework grading. And there is also the idea of potential use in automated e-exams. We are not at that point yet. And our technical base is the Moodle Learning Management System and the question type stack, which I have stuck to in the last 2 years. Stack has already been presented on this conference, so I can be very brief about that. Something which has not been said, I think it's not on the slide. So from my point of view as a mechanical engineer, the ability to handle units of measurement, that's quite interesting. But the focus today is on the interactive graphics using JSX graph. Yeah, I started my e-assessment activities quite 10 years ago or so with the question type calculated in Moodle, which was very limited. And 2 years ago, I found the, I got the chance to learn stack. And then I started to use multi-part questions, which give a better guidance for formative assessment. So you can scaffold the tasks by intermediate results. And a comparison between these two types of questions in terms of facility and discriminative efficiency, that's some statistics that Moodle provides, is in favor of the stack multi-part questions. A facility index means how many students did manage to get the answer right, and discriminative efficiency is how well is the result of that particular question related to the overall result in the test. Yeah, that's what this these figures say. And in favor of the e-assessment with STEC is that it is a powerful open source tool under active development. This is all three aspects: open source, active development, powerful. And I can replace repetitive work by content development and coding. That's what automation is about, and I like that, using a computer-aided teaching of mechanics. And the instant feedback is something which is appreciated by the students. So they can do the task whenever they want, and they do not have to wait for me for waking up next day and see if that is right, but they get it immediately. And also for me, very interesting is the feature of browsing through the response behavior of the students and see what they did, how they poked around to get the result right in 20 tries or things like that. And then I can think about how to support with reasonable feedback. Yeah, that's something which can be get better and better over time. And we are not dependent on a commercial supplier, which might stop service, and then we are left alone with our material. What is the downside is that the UI user interface comfort is very poor. If you edit your questions in the Moodle editor, you don't have any support for question editing. There's no syntax highlighting or whatever. We have seen how people fight with that. They take the text out of Moodle, copy it to somewhat syntax sensitive editor, and then paste that back. But that's advanced techniques which are not obvious to the beginner of STEC, which I was 2 years ago. And authoring questions is challenging because in the first step, okay, you need LaTeX. That's usual thing if you did scientific work, but Maxima was new to me, and at least at that level. And when starting with JSX Graph, I had also to fight with JavaScript and HTML. I had to learn JavaScript just for that purpose. And what I think, which will be the directions for further development of e-assessment at our school, at least in my subject, is that I will use the JSX Graph integration for one thing is dynamic graphics for randomized question text. That means the graphics, they are also randomized, and also for the worked solutions, and also the chance of graphical input up to free body diagrams, which I will show in a minute. And the requirements identified to support these developments is that we need to somehow make sure a consistent graphical appearance adjusted to what is the state of the art in mechanics, textbooks, and things like that, as to be consistent with the scientific way of sketching things. And then I also thought I need a generic concept of interaction between JSX Graph and STEC, because every time I try to author a question, I nearly had to look up everything anew. And because I forgot it from one week to the other with many other work in between. And so I had to reduce the complexity of authoring. And I was thinking about how I can do that. But first, let me show what we presented a year ago. Free body diagrams. What is a free body diagram? You have a physical structure, and which has supports and interfaces to other structures, to the environment. And if you want to compute the forces acting on this structure, you have to remove the environment and replace the action, the influence of the environment by forces and moments, so-called reactions. And so you remove the adjacent members of the system and replace them by reactions. And what you have to do is you have to allow the student to create these forces and moments. And these forces and moments can be named by the student, and Stack needs to know what these names are and what the directions of these arrows are and how many of them and where they are. That's required for later assessment. And 1 year ago, I have proved that this is possible with Stack and JSX Graph. So can you see my mouse? Otherwise, I try to switch on the pointer. That might be better.
Oh, yes, but we also saw the mouse.
Okay, but the pointer will do as well. So this is a sum of forces and moments about the origin of all these things that have been sketched in this area here. And I was really impressed by the also the visual quality of what can be produced with a stack question and all open source tools which are combined here. And how is it done? If you do a usual question with JSX Graph, you have in Stack, you have seen Stack multiple times here in this conference already, even if it's not on Stack, but I think you may have an impression. You first in Stack have to define question variables where the random values are generated, the reference solution is generated, and that's Maxima code. And in the question text, that's where the text display to the students is generated. You have then a JSX graph block that you insert and write your problem-specific JavaScript there. And then before and after, you can have ordinary question text like you would have in whatever stack question. And this example in the right corner here is a example for Morse circle. That's a graphical representation of a second order eigenvalue problem. So you have to place the circle in at the appropriate location and have to place the line at the appropriate location. And that can be done with some lines of JavaScript. And that's these nearly 40 lines here at that point. So that's quite straightforward and simple, but if you want to do that again, you need to remember what are all the commands in JSX graph and in JavaScript. And an alternative would be to put that, to control that exclusively from within from within Stack and Maxima. So I just have to double check. Seems there is a slide missing here, which I want to. Ah, okay. We can stick with what we see at the moment. Let me go here. So the sequence was not correct. This is a stack with JSX graph and Maclib. The same procedure, or the same task as just the last slide. And now what we do is we have a problem independent, entirely generic JavaScript code block in the question text. And the content of the widget is driven by a Maxima list of objects. And the list of objects is, you can see here in the blue box, this is the grid, the control of how big the widget is and what is the scaling of the box. And then you have a circle driven by two points and you have a line driven by two points with appropriate parameters. And that's the way how I control it, and the JSX graph block has to be able to handle such input. And this generic block I called it MECLIB, Mechanical Engineering Library. And now how it is done. This library consists of some HTML code and the header of the JSX graph block in stack. You have two hidden input fields. One is for the objects, which is string input and serves for storage of state. And the second is called names. That is algebraic input, which is required in order to use objects created and names created on JSX graph level in Maxima feedback calculation, because the string object state can't be evaluated. So I had to split that, and that was already the idea last year. And now it is implemented in the library. And this means that everything between JSX graph start and end is entirely problem independent. Nothing here is modified for a particular task question. Everything comes from outside, and this is one spot where the outside comes in. That is the variable init, which is evaluated here. And the JavaScript code writes the state to the input field objects and writes the names and other auxiliary information to the name, the input field names. And you can hide them, of course. And in the HTML here, it is hidden, but here I have switched off this hiding. And this is an overview of what objects you have. I designed the set of objects with mechanical systems in mind, two-dimensional of the elementary mechanical engineering, engineering mechanics. And the main groups of objects are annotations. So you have angular and linear dimensions, which I found very, very difficult, and was took a lot of work to do these things, like such an arrow, arc with arrow, and these auxiliary lines, and all the label placement took a lot of time and tryout for every task. And I said, okay, I have to do it once, and then in a way that I can access it at a very abstract level. And these arrows and dimensions like these ones, like in mechanical engineering, once you polish them on JavaScript side, you can reuse them wherever you want without having to think about how was that done in JavaScript. You can forget about JavaScript, or if you take this MECLIB and start doing stack questions, you do not even think of it once. I, of course, have to find solutions in JavaScript for all these objects, but once that is done, you can forget about it. And I have specific symbols for supports like this one, or for connectors like spring or dashpot, or ropes with nice tangent conditions, and distributed loads like this. And you see some of them are grayed out, so you can activate or deactivate them. You remember, for free body diagrams, you have to you have to switch off these, remove the environment of a given system. And but you do not want to completely remove it. You want to show what was there in order to place the appropriate forces. Then we have generic objects like circles and lines and things like that. And we have controls, which define the grid, or moment and force generators. These generators, if you have enough time, I can show them in the Moodle example live. You can just drag these forces to generate forces that you can place interactively. And you can remove them by double clicking, then they are gone, and you can also give their name in this input field. Okay, so some examples for application. The first application I had to do because interactivity was not available yet in this library, was non-interactive illustrations with consistent design. And all these images, they are entirely defined within stack, and each object here is a line in maximalist. And you can randomize that, of course, easily because it's part of the question variables. So that's a typical appearance of such an object that have a type. Perhaps some of them have a name that, which is used as a label, and some position, some other parameters, and many of them have a state parameter, switched off, switched on, things like that. And then for interactive free body diagrams, I designed the force and moment generator objects, so you can drag forces and objects to your image, and you can interactively switch off and on the sketch objects. So here, for instance, we have switched off the sliding support, the bar and the rope, and they are replaced by forces. And on the JavaScript level, I already have a proximity check, which says which of the new generated forces could be adjacent to what has been deactivated. And that's an important precondition for feedback on the maxima side. So, and if you see this image, that's the whole thing you have to do in maxima in order to define that image with all the functionality, including control of how you generate and delayed forces and moments, and all this is behind it's not seen, not exposed to the author. You can focus on the high level object. Then another example is interactive curve sketching. When I want to let the student input some curves, I have this spline object, which can represent cubic, quadratic, or linear curves, depending on whether I specify the slope in addition to the values at the boundary. And with two slopes and two boundary values, I have a cubic function. If just one slope is neglected, I have a quadratic function. And if both slopes aren't prescribed, I have, of course, a straight line. And the curves return their equation. And this is used in this question. So you can play around with the functions. And then if you press check in the stack question, I just display the response from JavaScript. And again, that's the code for the whole image. Okay, so I have to admit, I removed the label objects for these texts here because they would have bloated the image. And again, the more circle questions, which I already showed you. We have the custom grid scaling, so I can have custom ticks, not just 1, 2, 3 and so, but this can be customized using this factor F, which has this value 10, I think, or 50, yeah, 50. And I have these two lines, and in the names object, in the names input field, these objects will write their point coordinates. And so I can use that in the feedback. Another use is the, here I use the spline object again, but just for display. So I generate a dynamic randomized curve for a virtual material test. And I let the students read off values, and I have a interactive crosshair, which allows for reading off the values here, and then students have to do something with these values, answer questions on the material behavior. And the custom, the info box of this crosshair is customized. Okay, it is still gray, but that is work in progress, at least. The decimal precision can be customized from within these parameters here, and also the scaling. So you see that the vertical axis has 5 as a grid unit, and the horizontal has 0.5. So that's no problem. It's all done on this level here. I really did not tweak anything in the generic block of JSX graph. So the features, to summarize them, we have a slim construction set just for the objects, and the parametric sketches, they are high quality and consistent. This block is totally problem independent, and my problem dependent part is restricted to the question variables, which I have to provide anyways for randomization and feedback generation. And so if someone wants to use this library for creating material, he does not know JSX graph, and he does also not need to know JavaScript. And but he's of course using both of them. And so it is easy to make visually consistent things with that. And also I found it very exciting that I do not need to maintain a separate location where I have my images for the stack questions, PowerPoint slides or whatever, where you can generate your images. And so these questions are easy to reuse and also easy to maintain, because everything you need is inside the question. And a typical image, randomized image, requires 20% of the total authoring time of the question. So some facts: 40 objects, 1,500 lines of code. One hint is that you switch off the spell checking in your Moodle editor or in the browser. That's actually a browser feature, which how I found out. If you switch it on, then it slows you down with 1,500 lines of code in the input field. And this code is synchronized with JS Fiddle. So you can take the identical content of this library and put it to a JS Fiddle place. And you can also, I've integrated a link to such a Fiddle with where you can take the same list of lists as in Maxima can be used in JavaScript. So you can try out your images without stack even. And of course you do not have then the Maxima parameterization, but if you use just numbers, you can design your illustration for the question. Then there's a GitHub page for MacLib with a wiki for documentation. This is mainly currently in use by myself, because I can look up how was the parameter for the objects and best practices for feedback and things I stored there. And so it's my primary repository for work. I do not hide anything behind this wiki. I use it in everyday work. And the non-interactive versions of these objects, I use them for a year now nearly, and we have 150 questions and three authors, so me and two other students who did these things, and they cope with that. And this contributed to sort of maturation. But the interactive objects, they have been coded mainly in summer, holidays, and they need to be tested now. This is what I told about JavaScript and JS Fiddle. So this is a link, live link to a Java to a JS Fiddle page. And here you see the initialization data, the same as in the stack question, but here you can't use Maxima variables, of course. And then here comes the MacLib contents, and that's the widget, and the contents of the input fields is also reproduced in the Java in the Jazz Fiddle environment. And there's one issue which I want to raise here, or better perhaps in the Stack community, that's performance. If I profile the question, which I already showed, and I do some manipulations, and then I press prüfen or check, then the maxima and Stack need 19 seconds until they send the response. And Maclib needs just 1.5 seconds to reproduce the image. And then we have a trial of activity for typesetting the labels, which is 3 seconds in this test case. And so these 19 seconds, they suck, so to say. And I have to see what can be done. It doesn't seem that it is dependent, or our IT guys, they increased the CPU power and the memory. That did not help. So we think it might be an issue of database interaction between Stack and MySQL. And if nothing will help, we might even think of switching the Databank server. But that I have to be very sure, because I'm the only Stack user at our university, and also the only JSXGraph user. That's not me deciding what database we use. Okay, then let me just speak on some limitations. We have the testing is, of course, to be intensified. And we just can have a single widget. I did not test how I could put multiple widgets in one question. Multilingual questions, they work actually, but not perfectly. I do not have any system of qualified error messages in the library. And when I review the questions, then interactivity is not suppressed, which it should be perhaps. So I think I just leave the summary and outlook here. We have to advance with testing the interactive features, and then perhaps next year I can already report on the impact on the didactics of this new environment and features. And for the time being, thank you for your attention. A set of examples, I start in the beginning. The first example is an example where you have to replace the supports by forces. And the first step in replacing, making a free body diagram actually. So you remove the supports by double clicking them. You still see them, but they are clearly deactivated. And then these are force generators. You can put a name in there, A, let's say, and drag the force to where you want to have it. And the force vector has a custom info box, as you see. Here is the point coordinates. That's the vector coordinates. And so having the force parallel to the line of action of this bearing is the correct answer. So you could have it like this, or you could have it upwards. And then we put some other forces here for the bar and for the rope. And you see it is a little bit snapping here, so you can move it along, and then you do the check and should be everything okay. So that's what I complained about. It takes a while. Okay, and you get a feedback for any other. And if you made the arrow this direction, then you get feedback on that as well. So the feedback was not translated. I forgot to do that. I just made the question text bilingual. And some of the results, here that says at the sliding support, the reaction A is not in the right direction. That's what's said here, and the student should correct that. So the next question is similar. Again, takes a while to switch. So here we are. And here I already played around with it. I removed the force. That was the initial situation, and I want to place the resultants of distributed loads. And this distributed load can be deactivated, and I replace it by a force. And this force can be given its value as an expression. That means 3A is the grid spacing by the value of this distributed load Q0. So you see that the label of the force switches to that. And now you can do wrong things in various dimensions. And if you check that, they will complain, of course, that the load does not go through the centroid. So the resultant has to go through the centroid of the distributed load. That is what is written here. And please move the start point of the load to change location. So, and if we do that, then here the feedback computation in Maxima is much simpler. Then we get it right. Next example is on curves. That's essentially from my spline tutorial. Here we see that it is a function, a diagram made up of four splines. You can activate or deactivate them. Activate means it shows the handles. And you can give the slope. The length of this line is not significant. It's just the slope that matters. And if you do not care the slope, you put it just inside the circle, and then you get a lower order polynomial. And feedback is just providing you the expressions for the individual curves in this example. And then we have another. This is an actual question from a kinematics course. You have given a velocity profile. Okay, here's missing the horizontal axis, but that is not important. We have to provide the correct acceleration and location functions for given initial conditions. And the acceleration, of course, is the slope, and the location is the surface under the curve, under the velocity. So it will be a, let's say, like this. Let's have the acceleration right. We don't care the slope because it's just two constant values. Now, but we leave it like that and see what feedback we get. It's of course mostly wrong. So now we have the feedback, and the feedback is very detailed. So it gives you for the first part of the acceleration, it says the value is not correct at the location 2. And the second section region is correct. And in the position curve, we did nothing, but so that's not correct what we have here. And that would be a quadratic parabola with the slope at the end 0, because the velocity is 0, and the slope maximum in the center. We can leave it like this. Still not correct, but we will see the feedback. And so questions where we have multiple points to move up and down, and then the feedback says correct or wrong. That is a little bit unspecific of feedback, because the students do not know where to search for the error. And here the second part is correct. And the first part, it says the slope at point 2 is not correct. So you have to do something about this one. And if you put it there, it is correct. But I go to the next question at that point. So this is the Morse circle question. You have to put the, you have given the stress in normal stress in X direction is minus 70 megapascal, in Y direction is 50, and the shear stress is minus 20 megapascal. And the rule for constructing Morse circle is P has to go to sigma X and tau XY. So it's at minus 70 and at minus 20. So the info box helps a little. And the other point P prime is at 50 and plus 20. So 50 and 20. So that's, we can check if we did that right. So the complaint is that the slope of the one axis is not correct. So that's the direction of the first eigenvalue, the maximum principal stress. And this is made by going from the minimum principal stress to the point P, which is here. And we check that. So we are correct now. And so you understood the design rule of how to make Mohr circle, and you can read off the principal stresses at the intersection with the X axis, with the horizontal axis. And that is the direction of maximum principal stress. And as I said, this is made by just some lines. This is actually the initial situation. That is the model answer. If you ask for the correct solution in the preview, then this is used. And here's some randomization stuff, which is independent of this graphics. And here you have 1,500 lines of code, which you just paste in. And then let me go to the last example. I just cancel and should be back in the test. This is the last example with the diagram, I guess. Yeah, that's the dynamically created diagram. And this is the crosshair. And you have to, can, this is also snapping to the curve. So you can read off easily the coordinates. Here, it would be nice to have control by the cursor keys. I was not able to do that in the JSX graph version I have in stack. And yeah, the students have to use this diagram and respond to some questions based on that. Where for instance, they need the Young's modulus, which is the slope of this line, which I, what I want to do or have to do still is to switch off highlighting so that they don't exactly know where the straight line is, where the interface is between the individual parts. They have to judge from the curve and not from the highlighting. And then I asked them if they go, if they extend a specimen to 4.2%, that is somewhere here, and then release the load, what would be the residual strain? And that can be answered all with this diagram. And that's a demonstration of the objects, of interactive objects defined so far in this library. Thank you for your attention.